The psychopaths killed another American this month. Dave Johnson over at Alternet is telling the story of Norman Rousseau and his wife, two people who did everything they were supposed to do. They were responsible homeowners who did business with Wells Fargo. And they put a 30% down payment on this house in California back in 2000. And they made every payment from then on, never missed even one single month. At the same time, the housing bubble frenzy took off. Banks discovered they could make enormous profits, dragging homeowners away from fixed and safe fixed-rate mortgages and into exploding adjustable-rate mortgages. For the bank, it didn't matter if the interest rate on the new loan would skyrocket and eventually lead to a foreclosure. The banks got their money no matter what, either through missed payment fees, late payment fees, refinancing fees, and after foreclosure, they get government support and tax write-offs on the underlying value of the property, which they end up with. As a corporation, a bank, Wells Fargo has only one obligation: increase profits for its shareholders. That's it. To hell with their customers, their community, their nation, just so long as they're hitting that bottom line goal, and Wells Fargo is doing exactly what it's legally obligated to do. If Wells Fargo was a person and didn't give a damn about their fellow man and was willing to do whatever it takes, lie, cheat, steal, kill, for profit, then we'd call that person a psychopath. If a psychopath had defrauded a person and then harassed her to the point of committing suicide to get it to stop, we'd like lock that psychopath up and keep him away from society. But as a corporation, we give companies like Wells Fargo tax breaks and bailouts and turn the other way when they drive their customers to suicide. So in 2007, Wells Fargo's salesman decided to prey on one of their customers, Norman Rousseau. According to court documents, the bank approached the Rousseaus about changing their mortgage from the fixed rate that they had, the nice stable mortgage, safe mortgage, to an adjustable rate mortgage, an ARM. The Rousseaus stressed that they were really only interested in a fixed rate loan, and that they wanted to pay the exact same payments throughout the life of their loan. But they trusted the bank, which was a big mistake. So when Wells Fargo told them that the new industry standard is adjustable rate mortgages, and they could save more than $600 a month in mortgage payments, and that the worst case scenario would be an increase of only a few dollars on their monthly payments, according to Alternet, the Rousseaus gave in to the salesman and took the new mortgage. But as Alternet reports, a few years later, in 2009, the Rousseaus knew that they were stuck with a bad deal. Their new interest rate was higher than it was before 2007, and even before, even higher than what they were told it could increase to. But as responsible homeowners who had done everything they were supposed to do, the Rousseaus still made each and every monthly payment on time. And that's when Wells Fargo, behaving like a true psychopath, moved in for the kill. In May of that year, the bank claimed the Rousseaus missed a monthly payment. The Rousseaus said, that's impossible. They'd made the payment. They even gave proof that they made the payment at the bank with a cashier's check, and that check had been cashed by the bank. They had it. But the bank still claimed it never received the payment. And a few months later, the Rousseaus again missed another payment in June and another in July, even though Norman Rousseau had personally, again, hand-delivered a cashier's check to the bank to pay each of those months. Finally, the bank recognized its error. And in August, they told the Rousseaus, hey, you're current on all your payments. But according to Alternet, a few months later, Wells Fargo went back to the same scheme, again claiming a missed payment and then hitting the Rousseaus with fee after fee, penalty after penalty. Over the next few years, this sort of back-and-forth double-talk Kafka-esque nightmare continued between Wells Fargo and Norman Rousseau. The fees kept piling up, as did the lies from the bank, and then the eviction notices came rolling in. By 2012, the financial burden of the whole ordeal became unbearable. And the Rousseaus, like so many other Americans in the middle of the housing meltdown, were getting wiped out by the increased mortgage payments. That's when Wells Fargo finished them off, setting the eviction date of May 15th for when Norman Rousseau and his wife had to be out of their house. The Rousseaus considered moving into an RV in front of their home, but that plan didn't work out either. So 2 days before the scheduled eviction, Norman Rousseau, apparently unable to bear losing his home after the bank had already taken all his money, pulled out a gun and killed himself, leaving behind a devastated wife.
I lost my husband, and it hurts me like hell. I don't want this to happen to anybody. This is horrible. I lost my husband. I lose my pets, I lose my house, I lose my furniture, everything, for nothing.
The family bought the home.
For the news in Wells Fargo, it was just another casualty of our economy, now under the control of corporate psychopaths. But how many more lives have to be ruined before our nation wakes up to the fact that everything that makes life worth living in America is being stolen by psychopathic executives sitting on the boards and steering the wheels of the nation's biggest corporations? Our economy today is rooted in this form of corporate capitalism, which relies on an insatiable drive for more and more profits. It basically relies on blind greed. You see, it's not just in homeowners being pushed off the edge, but in entire cities that are poisoned by corporate chemical and energy plants that spew their pollution downstream. You see it in for-profit health insurance companies that use actual death panels to deny women and children life-saving medical procedures to keep up their quarterly profits. You see it in defense companies that lobby Congress for more war just so they can sell more and more tanks and warplanes and bombs, regardless of how many deaths it'll mean. Do these corporations ever show any remorse for the damage they cause? Did Wells Fargo think twice about how they'd handle their next foreclosure victim after Norman Rousseau blew his head off? As far as we can tell, the answer is no. At least not as long as the profits keep rolling in. This is genuinely psychopathic behavior. Norman Rousseau put a gun to himself this month, but he's not the one who really pulled the trigger. Corporate psychopaths did. And any one of us could be the next Norman Rousseau as long as our nation continues this embrace of free market, psychopathic, corporate capitalism. It's time to look for something new. It's time to build a new economy that puts shareholder profits behind the well-being of customers, workers, and communities. Right now, the best alternative out there is the worker cooperative model. Businesses owned by the workers, where profits are shared and decisions are democratized. Over 1 billion people around the world do business with a cooperative. And here in the United States, there are over 11,000 worker-owned cooperatives, employing more Americans that are members of the entire private sector labor movement. You can see the success of the cooperatives in places like Madison, Wisconsin. I visited there last year. I did a speak at the Fighting Bob Fest. And the guy who picked me up at the airport, the cab driver from Union Cab Company, says, I used to be a lawyer, now I'm a cab driver. What? Oh, I'm also an owner of the company. To manufacturing plants, I visited Isthmus Manufacturing in Madison, Wisconsin, owned by its employees. Even the strip clubs in Madison, which I didn't visit, probably should have. Anyway, are organized as worker-owned co-ops and are achieving great success without psychopathic violence. It's simple. We can build a new economy that works for all of us and depends on cooperation rather than predation. Or we can stick to what we have now, this corporate system that is basically draining us. It's sucking the life out of the middle class. And we can let the free market corporate psychopaths continue to run roughshod over this nation. We have to figure out which way we're going to go. And there really are choices. This cooperative model that Mondragon is doing in Spain and that 11,000 companies are doing in the United States really works. It really works well. And you could argue that it's not an alternative to capitalism, that it is a form of capitalism, only the capital that's brought to the table is not, you know, a rich guy like Mitt Romney saying, okay, you know, we're going to bring in a bank and buy a company and load them up with debt and strip them naked. Instead, it's people bringing sweat equity, bringing their capital, their labor to the company. It works. The time to choose this is now.